Hi, everybody. Good evening. Thank you for joining us. I'd like to give you all a very warm welcome to the latest edition of Talking Disputes, where we'll be discussing the WTO panel report on the India solar cells case, which is DS456. First, to introduce myself, my name is Sofia Valigno. I'm the editor of British Weekly at the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development, or ICTSD, and I will be moderating this evening's panel. For those of you new to these events, I'd like to just give a very brief overview to how Talking Disputes works and what the objective is. So the series is co-organized by both ICTSD and WTI advisors. It's designed to allow for discussion of specific WTO disputes by experts and interested professionals from relevant fields. We've invited these speakers coming from various different perspectives who will present their views and give us a lot of rich material for our discussion this evening. We'll also have ample time for question and answer so that we can get your feedback, your insights, your comments. We'd also like to thank the permanent mission of Finland to the WTO for providing their very valuable support in the organization of today's event. We'd also like to remind everyone, and I'll remind everyone again before the end, that at your seats you'll see there are some feedback forms. If you all could fill them out either during the event or at the very end, that would be extremely useful for us. And then you just leave them there as you go, and that way we can keep growing and developing the series going forward. Now, before I move on to our panel and our introductions, I'd like to just give a few brief words on ICTSD's work on trade in relation to clean energy technologies and climate change. So the reason why ICTSD has a program that's dedicated specifically to trade in clean energy technologies is first and foremost because of climate change. Fossil fuel-based energy use is the biggest contributor to anthropogenic greenhouse gas emissions, which is why a rapid scale-up and deployment of renewable or sustainable energy sources will be a critical component in pursuing global climate goals, and especially post-Paris, of countries' individual climate plans. A switch to cleaner and low-carbon transport fuels and technologies, as well as greater energy efficiency measures, are also necessary to achieve a 1.5 to 2 degree Celsius goal. In addition to addressing climate change, scaling up clean energy comes with a number of sustainable development gains. It can address energy poverty by enhancing access to modern forms of energy among populations that currently rely on wood or kerosene, for example. By doing so, it would also address related health concerns that result from indoor pollution. It'll spur economic activity and growth, and it'll even help with gender imbalances and land conflicts. It can also improve energy security, as countries may not need to rely entirely on imports of oil, coal, and gas, which are often at very volatile prices. And lastly, it can help spur green growth, helping to generate jobs in areas ranging from manufacturing to services. And while these modes are all crucial, they may not be enough to treat clean energy differently from a trade perspective, as these can be achieved through other means. The climate imperative is, however, in our opinion, strong enough, and the climate challenge is quite pressing, and we're hoping that clean energy is the key to responding to it in a timely manner. In this context, having a trade policy perspective is crucial. The sector actually faces a range of public interventions, often with contradictory messages. On the one hand, there's a need to stimulate the development of the sector to allow it to become a viable option to fossil fuels. Therefore, many governments adopt renewable energy targets, and those in a position to do so implement a range of incentives, such as feed-in tariff schemes and other kinds of subsidies. There are also increasingly efforts being made to put a price on carbon, thereby making the substitution to clean energy bear its full environmental cost and eventually level the playing field. At the same time, fossil fuel subsidies continue to be provided both for production and for consumption. There's also an overuse of trade remedies in the clean energy sector, often not linked to actual dumping, but rather reflecting technology improvement, a steep learning curve, and steep price cuts. And these policies and measures go against climate goals agreed to in Paris last December and the sustainable energy goals, goal number 7, adopted last September. Regarding local content requirements, which we'll be talking about quite a bit today, in broad terms, it can be said that policymakers are trying to pursue several objectives using one tool: to stimulate the domestic economy, create jobs, and address climate change. In assessing such measures, it's crucial to bear in mind that the overarching objective, following the logic above, is climate action. Will these LCRs contribute to scaling up this climate action? And are these necessary to allow countries to implement climate policies, which may otherwise be seen as costly and unpopular? Or do these LCRs actually delay the shift to clean energy by making the technologies more expensive and direct producers toward less efficient technologies? So against this whole background, ICTSD has really taken a holistic approach to clean energy and trade, where we have identified the relevant goods through an advanced mapping exercise based on IPCC work, after which customs experts have identified the relevant HS codes to facilitate tariff reduction of relevant goods. We've also made attempts to identify the relevant services and proposed options regarding how to facilitate trade in these services. We've mapped existing patents in the clean energy sector. We've also looked in depth into issues relating to government procurement, standards, and subsidies, including LCRs, and are currently undertaking 4 studies that explore value chains in different clean energy categories, such as wind, solar, and biomass, to better understand the drivers and obstacles for trade in these, with an emphasis on standards. We're also exploring the development opportunities for engaging in trade reform and clean energy. Under this approach, we've even proposed a Sustainable Energy Trade Agreement, or SETA, and we've initiated and hosted an industry alliance, the SETI Alliance, to work with us in supporting the case for trade reform and clean energy. Within ICTSD's and the World Economic Forum's N15, E15 project, one expert group was fully dedicated to clean energy and was led by our chief executive, Ricardo Menéndez Ortiz. We're very pleased that some of the members of this group are on the panel, and we'll be able to relay some of the discussions of that group. I also know that several of the group's members are going to be watching us online. We're also leading 2 projects that are highly relevant to today's topic. And one of these is relating to the issue of fossil subsidy reform and the possible links to trade governance. One's about addressing the overuse of trade remedies in the clean energy sector. And the latter builds to a great extent on the work of the E15, which identified a variety of options for disciplining the use of trade remedies specifically in the clean energy sector, ranging from a stricter application of current rules to more ambitious reforms, like introducing a climate criterion and public interest tests, to even a full moratorium. And now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to today's speakers. We've got 3 of them here in Geneva, and we've got one of them joining us online. And they are going to be looking at this issue from a range of different perspectives, and I'm sure will give us quite a lot to talk about. First, we have Dr. Jan Bohannes sitting next to me here. Jan is a counsel at the Advisory Center on WTO Law, where he advises developing country governments on all matters of WTO law, including on dispute settlement proceedings before WTO panels and the appellate body. Jan will be giving us an overview of the panel's key findings, and he'll provide some views in this respect. Then we have Dr. Freya Betanz, who's here with us today, and she's Associate Professor of Law at the Europa Institute of Leiden Law School and Director of the LUC Research Center at the Faculty of Governance and Global Affairs at Leiden University. Currently, she's also visiting professor at the National University of Singapore. Well, except for right now when she's here with us. Along with her academic activities, she's also assisted several international arbitration panels, and she regularly acts as counsel or expert in international disputes as an associate lawyer with VVGB Avocat in Brussels. And Freya is also going to comment on the legal implications of the dispute. Next, we have Dr. William Blythe, who's worked for 20 years in the analysis of energy security and climate change. He's an associate fellow of Chatham House, and he's an honorary research fellow at Imperial College London. He is director of Oxford Energy Associates, an independent energy research company. He's an expert in energy sector economics and policies, specializing in transitions to low-carbon economies and energy access in developed and developing countries. And William will be giving us some of his insights on energy policy. And then joining us online is Aaron Cosby, who's an environmental economist with 25 years' experience in the areas of trade, investment, and sustainable development. He's a senior associate with the International Institute for Sustainable Development. And Aaron will be focusing on policy aspects relating to trade, investment, and climate change in the context of this dispute. And now, without further ado, I'd like to move on to Jan, who's going to give us his presentation. Jan, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Sophia. Thank you to ICTSD and WTI advisors for organizing this event and for inviting me. I will introduce the case. So what is this case about? Let's see if we
get some movement.
That does not count towards my speaking time, right?
You're good.
There we go. Excellent. So, what are the measures at issue here? So, the measures at issue are domestic content requirements. Sophia already mentioned those. They were imposed under the Nehru National Solar Mission, which is a program established by the government of India in 2010. And the objective of this program is basically to establish India as a global leader in solar energy and support the diffusion of the energy across the country. And this program fits into sort of the broader scheme of India's National Action Plan on Climate Change. And climate change plays a role also in some of the international agreements that India invoked in this case. And these domestic content requirements are imposed on certain entities that sell solar electricity to government agencies. And I have a slide that I devoted a lot of time to, as you may see, to help us visualize how this program works. So you have the government of India at the center that buys solar electricity from SPDs, solar power developers. And it's the government enters into these long-term agreements, 25 years, at guaranteed rates with these solar power producers. But it obliges them to buy the solar cells and solar panels from Indian producers of solar cells and solar panels. So they may not, if they buy the solar cells and solar panels from foreign producers, they are not allowed, they're not eligible to participate, they're not eligible for these long-term power purchase agreements, PPAs, they're not eligible for these guaranteed rates. And then the government of India resells this electricity to so-called distribution companies, DISCOMs. And these entities then sell on to consumers, commercial and retail consumers. Now, for many of you, this will be strongly reminiscent of the facts in Canada feed-in tariffs case, and indeed this case looms large over this case. The facts are very, very, very similar. And it was frequently referenced by the parties in their legal arguments as well. I have a picture here of the solar cells and solar modules or panels so that we know what we're talking about. So solar cells are obviously the devices that convert solar light into electricity, and solar panels or modules, which are interchangeable terms, are composed of multiple cells. Now, what's interesting, this is actually a limited reproduction of a chart that you find in the panel report. What's interesting here is that these domestic content requirements were sort of phased in over time. They were expanded over time. So the whole program is divided into phases, which you see on the left-hand side, phases and batches. So the program is divided into phases, and in each phase you have batches, which are these groups of PPAs, these power purchase agreements that the government enters into. And as you sort of go in time, then the scope of the domestic content requirements expands. So you see in the first phase, batch one, you had domestic content requirements only for these crystalline silicon modules, so for one type of generation equipment. And as you move further in time, the scope of the domestic content requirement expands. And so the last period that is on this table, you are not allowed to use any foreign cells or modules here. These measures, these domestic content requirements, they're contained in a range of measures that it's not terribly important here for our discussion, but just to sort of mention these acts. They're guidelines issued by the Indian Energy Ministry. They're requests for selections, which were issued by the agencies that actually run the programs. There's a model power purchase agreement, and then you have the actual individual power purchasing agreements. And all of these documents contain the domestic content requirements. So you're only eligible as a solar power producer if you respect these domestic content requirements. So those are basically the measures. Complainant, the United States, alleged two violations. One is Article 2.1 of the TRIMS agreement, of the Agreement on Trade-Related Investment Measures, and the other is good old Article 3.4. So both have to do, obviously, with national treatment. This is what domestic content is about. Now, interestingly, the U.S. had an original request for consultations where they also invoked provisions under the SCM agreement, Article 3.1b, which are local content requirements, and Articles 5 and 6 of the SCM agreement, which go to adverse effects or serious prejudice. And then the U.S. dropped those claims. So they have a revised request for consultations. And what happened between the two is the Canada feed-in tariffs case was issued, which, of course, as many of you will know, is the very complicated analysis of benefit. And so one can sort of speculate that the United States decided they were not going to bother with the complicated benefit analysis and were not going to pursue these complaints under the SCM agreement. The case, in fact, is a lot simpler from this perspective than Canada feed-in tariffs. It just focuses on Article 2.1 and 3.4. Who are the panelists? Often when we speak about panel reports, we don't mention the specific panelists, so I thought I would mention that. You have the chairman, who's David Walker, who is a New Zealand government official. You have Marco Tulio Molina Tejeda, who is a Guatemalan government official based here in Geneva, and Mr. Pornchai Dhanvivatana from Thailand. Those are the three panelists here, supported by a team from the Legal Affairs Division. So, the actual claims. So the United States invoked a violation of Article 2.1 of the TRIMS Agreement, and Article 2.1 of the TRIMS Agreement prohibits measures that are inconsistent with Article 3 of the GATT, so there's a link between the two. There's an illustrative list of the measures that are deemed to violate Article 3.4, and paragraph 1A of this illustrative list refers to measures that require the purchase or use of products of domestic origin. And domestic content requirements, it's no brain surgery to conclude that these measures are covered by this paragraph. And the panel indeed found that the measures are trade-related investment measures, that they're covered by paragraph 1A. There's a bit of discussion in the report about the relationship between the TRIMS Agreement and Article 3.4. India was arguing that one should first conduct a full-fledged analysis under Article 3.4, but the panel said no. The case law means that you just look at what is in paragraph 1A of the TRIMS Agreement. There's no need for a separate and additional analysis under Article 3.4. And so the panel on that basis finds a violation of Article 2.1 of the TRIMS Agreement. So we have a first finding of violation because these measures mandate, require the use of domestic content over foreign content. So fairly straightforward here. Now what the panel does then, although it's not strictly necessary, they also make an additional finding under Article 3.4. This is something that WTO panels do on a routine basis. They make additional findings in order to enable the appellate body, if the appellate body reverses the previous finding, that it can complete the analysis and there are no factual findings missing. So the panel makes the finding under Article 3.4. It affirms the existence of like products. There's a de jure discrimination here, less favorable treatment. India made certain arguments that there's no less favorable treatment because, for instance, imported products have the bulk of the market share and domestic products have a very small market share. This was rejected by the panel. Unsurprisingly, of course, there's case law that says these are not the kind of arguments you can raise against the less favorable treatment. But now we come to the defenses that India raised. And the first one was Article 3.8a of the GATT. And that's an exception or a carve-out for measures that go to government procurement. So India was arguing that the Indian government is procuring here a product that effectively they're procuring for government use, for governmental purpose, these solar cells and solar modules. That's what Article 3.8 goes to. It covers rules, carves out from the scope of 3.4 rules that govern the procurement of products purchased for governmental purposes and not for commercial resale. And here, again, the panel makes the finding that was sort of very analogous to what happened in Canada feed-in tariffs, what the appellate body said, is that the product purchased here, if you remember the big chart, we had the products that being purchased by the government is electricity. But the product discriminated against our solar cells and solar panels. Right? Those are the requirements. Those are the products that India wants to foster its manufacturing capacity. And so there's a mismatch between these products. And the appellate body found that in order for 3A to kick in, the two products have to be the same. They have to compete. And the panel finds that these products do not compete. Now, there's quite a bit of discussion then in the panel report about inputs. The appellate body left open in Canada feed-in tariffs that maybe Article 3.8a could cover inputs, right? So if the government is procuring something but is discriminating, it's requiring the use of domestic inputs, maybe there's sort of a wrinkle in how Article 3.8a applies. And India sort of relied on that and tried to argue that, in fact, there's such a close connection, such an integral link between the solar cells and solar panels and the electricity that you cannot really differentiate between the two, that effectively the government is procuring solar cells and solar panels rather than electricity. And the panel, relying on what the appellate body had said in Canada feed-in tariffs, rejected that. Now, then the panel went on to make additional findings about other elements of Article 38A. For instance, what does it mean to procure for governmental purpose? What does it mean commercial resale? Largely, the panel makes factual findings to enable the appellate body to make its findings, if need be, on appeal. They don't make full-fledged legal findings, but it makes for very interesting reading. It's a very, very well-drafted panel report, by the way. The second defense that India raises, and this is sort of the thing that perhaps is the one of the really interesting aspects of this case, is that India invoked Article 20J, which is a provision that has never been invoked previously. So I actually had to look up what 20J says when I first saw this, and so for your benefit, I reproduced it here. Article 20J justifies measures that are essential to the acquisition or distribution of products in general or local short supply. And there's a proviso in Article 20J that says, well, but all contracting parties or all WTO members are entitled to an equitable share of international supply of these products. And when the local, when the short supply disappears, the measures have to be discontinued. Now, this provision had been put in place originally, and the panel sort of explains that very nicely. It was initially created for a limited period of time to address transitional periods dealing with shortages following World War II. So the idea is here that if you have a shortage of products, you can impose, for instance, export restrictions in order to enable you to sort of, distribute these products domestically, but you have to ensure that all contracting parties get an equitable share. And this provision was meant to expire. It was a temporary measure, but then it was repeatedly extended by GATT contracting parties until it was in 1970. It was sort of left in place indefinitely. But sort of the idea was that it's here for emergencies. And what India argued here is that, look, we have an obligation, we have an international obligation to foster renewable energy, to engage in the global fight against climate change. And for that, we need to foster domestic industry. And we can only do domestic production of cells and modules. And we have to make sure that we have an adequate supply of these cells and modules in case there's a disruption of international supply. So we have to foster this domestic manufacturing capacity. That's the idea. So India was arguing that because there is a shortage of domestic manufacturing capacity, there is short supply within the meaning of 20J. And the panel rejects that. The panel makes a sort of textual, contextual analysis and says short supply is something different, doesn't mean lack of domestic manufacturing capacity. So it rejects sort of this argument by India. It also says, look, if we accept what you're saying, then there's no objective benchmark to determine when you have a lack of domestic capacity, production capacity, right? You could go to 100%. You could cover 100% of your domestic demand through domestic capacity. There's no objective benchmark where to stop. India also argue that 20J could cover risk of short supply, and the panel sort of has an interesting analysis of that and says, well, we don't think so. You cannot sort of preemptively assume that there might be a risk down the road, at some point down the road, but even assuming 20J covers risk, it would have to be imminent risk. It would have to be imminent shortage, and that wasn't demonstrated in this case. And then India has another defense under Article 20D. And now 20D protects measures that are necessary to secure compliance with laws or regulations that are not inconsistent with the GATT. It's a bit of a layered provision, so I put in this sort of chart to illustrate what's happening here. So you have the first box, which would be laws and regulations not inconsistent with the GATT. The second box would be those measures that have been found to be inconsistent. So here it would be the domestic content requirements. And the measure can be justified if the measure in the second box is a tool to enforce the first box, to ensure compliance with the first box, and to prevent the people in the third box, these complying persons or entities, from acting inconsistently with these laws and regulations that are not inconsistent. So there's sort of a chain. Now, India was in arguing that into the first box, it could fit either international legal obligations or domestic legal obligations. And for international law, India was pointing to a whole range of documents, preamble of the WTO agreement, and very prominently the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, as well as certain other declarations, the United Nations General Assembly resolution, etc. So India was saying, look, the domestic content requirements, we need them to enforce these international norms. So the international norms go into the first box, and the domestic content requirements are a way of enforcing these international requirements. And the panel then relied on previous case law by the appellate body, Mexico Soft Drinks, and it said, look, you can rely on international law, but only if it's been incorporated actually into your legal order, or the second option, if it has direct effect. And here it found that India had not demonstrated that these international agreements had direct effect, because India stated that there would be a need for implementing action by the executive branch. And so then India relied on domestic instruments in order to say these domestic content requirements, they enforce certain other domestic laws and are necessary to enforce those laws. But what the panel found is that the documents that India put forward, for instance, the National Energy Plan, the National Energy Policy, certain other documents, that in their majority they were not legally enforceable. They had only hortatory language, they had aspirational language, they had programmative language, they were descriptive. And so they didn't qualify in the panel's view under 20D. There was one provision under India's Electricity Act that the panel did accept, which was a provision that obliged the government to issue a national electricity plan. And the panel accepted that that is a law or regulation within the meaning of 20D, but it said that the domestic content requirements were not a measure to secure compliance with that, because it said at most the domestic content requirements might further the objectives, but they are not here to enforce. There's nothing to be enforced here from the National Electricity Act. So the panel then cuts off the analysis here. Well, it doesn't. It concludes that 20J and 20D are not available to India. But again, what the panel does, again, very nicely, it says, well, just in case, you know, we might get reversed, we'll make these sort of additional factual findings without making firm legal conclusions, but just sort of to describe the issues that the appellate body might rely on. They look at contribution, so at necessity, right? So they conduct the necessity analysis, or the analysis of what essential is under 20J. And they look at the contribution that these measures are making and says, well, have these domestic content requirements actually done something to expand the scope, the domestic production in India? It makes for very interesting reading. Largely, the evidence that the panel discusses is not favorable sort of for a good effect of these domestic content requirements. The panel says we haven't seen much increase in scope of domestic production. And then domestic producers actually, they colluded, they cartelized, they raised prices, they made it more difficult to implement these solar projects. And but there's no legal conclusion here, but sort of interesting factual discussions. Panel also looks at alternative measures that the United States had put forward. For instance, stockpiling, facilitating investment. So the U.S. was saying here are other things that India could do. Again, the panel discusses those, but doesn't come to a legal conclusion because it had already arrived at a legal conclusion. Okay, I'm getting a red card here that I'm finished with my speaking time, but I have one more slide, if I may. So just a few aspects, a few salient aspects that sort of reflect my comments here. The legal result here is fairly foreseeable. I mean, these were domestic content requirements, and these are very hard to justify. So even if you are invoking, you know, the very important policy goals of mitigating climate change and fostering solar energy, local content requirements are just hard to justify within the WTO legal framework. And the panel sort of explains it very nicely. It's a very well-drafted panel report, flows very nicely. It makes all these additional findings in order to support the appellate body upon appeal, but it makes them, as I said, only at a factual level, mostly at a factual level, doesn't reach these legal conclusions. It's almost a textbook example of a panel report that reaches the necessary legal conclusions, but then prepares the ground for the appellate body for appeal. So really, really good panel report. It's a first time that Article 20J has been invoked. And given the way it's been interpreted by the panel, it's likely never going to be invoked again. I have a nice quote by Brendan McGivern, who is a partner here at the Wyden Case Office. He said, Article 20J has been awoken from its decades-long slumber, got interpreted in an appropriately narrow way, and it will likely return to its prior state of dormancy. And I think you cannot put it really better than this. It's the first time also that a member has sought to invoke international obligations relating to climate change. That's a first. Of course, as we have seen, it was rejected for a number of reasons, but it's a first sort of at that level as well. Interesting discussion under Article 38A and the issue of inputs, right? So how can you justify, well, can Article 38A apply in the case of inputs and under which conditions? I thought the discussion under 20D was interesting about these international legal obligations and what laws and regulations are. And finally, as I said before, this case really underscores the difficulty of justifying local content, domestic content requirements, and the underlying violation of national treatment, which is really a bedrock principle of this organization. And I think the case really shows that it's hard to do, even if you have sort of laudable overall policy intentions. I'll leave it at that.
Great. Jan, thank you so much for that excellent overview and helping get us started. I'd now like to pass the floor over to Freya. It's all yours.
Does this mean it works or it doesn't work?
Yeah, if it's red, you're on.
Okay, good. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'm very glad to be here. Thank you very much to the ICTSD for inviting me. Thank you very much for all of you to show up. I've been asked to provide a legal analysis of this case, not so much from a trade law perspective. You've had that already, a very competent one, so I won't do the same exercise twice, but rather from an environment, international environmental law and international investment law perspective. So what does this case mean beyond this building, beyond trade law? And for international environmental law, I will be briefly looking at, well, sustainable development, climate change, what kind of laws are there, how did India try to invoke them, and how is, more concretely, the promotion of green energy through domestic content requirements, how does India try to justify that? And then secondly, I will be looking at international investment law, where the term more often used is performance requirements, with that includes domestic content requirements, and renewable energy incentivization schemes in investor-state arbitration, because you may know that there's more than 50 cases going on precisely on this topic in investment law as well. And that might also be relevant or at least interesting for trade lawyers to be aware of the interpretations there. So very, very brief recap on Article 20D, the justification that was invoked by India, which was necessary to secure compliance with laws and regulations which are not inconsistent with the provisions of this agreement. So what India tried to argue was that DRC measures are needed to secure its compliance with laws or regulations, and there are laws or regulations that require India to take steps, specifically these steps, to promote sustainable development, and India based that argument on domestic legal instruments, general policies, and international instruments. Now, you've already briefly seen these instruments listed on Jan's slides. So first of all, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Now, this convention was signed by virtually every country in the world, ratified by nearly every country as well. Why was it so successful? Because it does not contain very specific binding obligations. I think everybody will agree that, virtually everybody will agree that climate change is a bad thing, we should do something against it, and that's where more or less where the agreement stops, whether that should be via binding international commitments, voluntary undertakings, etc. That's where countries disagree. You will have heard of the Kyoto Protocol. Well, the Kyoto Protocol is the protocol to the UNFCCC, specifically because after everybody went home happy, they realized that actually nothing much had been concluded, nothing much would be done for sure. So they needed a document like the Kyoto Protocol that would set fixed emission reduction targets. India could not invoke that, or it could refer to it, but under the Kyoto Protocol, the only binding obligations are for industrialized states. So for developing countries, it's more a statement of intent to reduce. Now, second one, the WTO preamble, just under general public international law, preambles are, of course, part of binding treaties, but they do, again, not set specifically binding obligations themselves. And then with regard to the last two, the Rio Declaration on Environment and Development, as well as the General Assembly resolution, these things are not binding. So these, again, are statements of intent. They give you an indication how states think about things, what they might want to do in the future, but they do not contain binding obligations. arguably, what the content of these documents by now has crystallized into customary international law, which would make it binding. But I think we've all seen in a number of other cases where countries have tried to argue customary law, for example, with regard to the precautionary principle, that the WTO is not terribly keen, and I would say understandably so, to suddenly start deciding general matters of public international law or international environmental law. So the problem with these documents was that the legal status was, in the first two cases we're talking about treaties, but the binding obligations was rather ambiguous, rather vague, and you couldn't really read into it what India was arguing. So the panel said most of the instruments identified by India did not constitute laws or regulations within the meaning of the article, and that applied to the international instruments, so treaties, customary law, as well as the general policy goals, because they were not considered specific enough, or at least not leading to such specific measures. Or the panel said these are not laws or regulations in respect of which the DCR measures secure compliance, and that then applies to this Electricity Act, which Jan already discussed. But these criteria, from a public international law, environmental law perspective, are very problematic because international law, international environmental law, generally does not have direct effect. I mean, even WTO law would not necessarily have direct effect. Often treaties are not incorporated in domestic law, are not part of the domestic legal system. Environmental treaties in particular often do not contain any obligations to perform specific acts which would meet that threshold of necessary to secure compliance. That's uncommon. In some cases, it's even undesired, because countries specifically do not want to bind themselves. They're happy to agree on the general purpose, but not happy to agree on specific goals. So although I agree with the analysis of the panel, it's by the very nature of international environmental law that you know, there was no other conclusion possible. I do think it was a bit of a lopsided comparison with Mexico taxes on soft drinks. So the panel used the reference to the countermeasures in that case to say, well, you know, this is why also we can't accept these measures in this case. I would say this case was different, and I'm happy during the questions to go into that further, because these, or at least had India's argument been accepted, this would have considered primary obligations. So it was not so much India trying, well, countermeasures essentially are things that are unlawful, that you're doing in response to an unlawful act. This was not the case here. Here we're talking about a primary obligation, if it had at least been accepted by the panel as being incorporated in these international instruments. Now, for discussion, and this will perhaps show you that I'm more coming from the public international law angle, okay, and not that I'm not, you know, a core trade lawyer. I was wondering, why did India not try some of the other justifications? And probably you'll give me the perfect answer to that. But for example, I thought, well, you could have tried under exhaustible natural resources, particularly because in U.S. gasoline, the panel actually held, and that was not appealed, that clean air can be seen as an exhaustible natural resource. And air quality in India has fallen dramatically, and also under this provision, it only needs to relate to the conservation goal. And I was also thinking, because I work in the Netherlands, of a recent decision in the Netherlands in the Urgenda case, where the Dutch District Court indeed looked at very much the same provisions, actually, with regard to climate change, and held that these do contain at least sufficiently, can be narrowed down to sufficiently mandatory obligations. And in that case, the Dutch government was held to have been in violation. The appeal is pending. It's very controversial, and it's quite likely that it will be overturned. But it's a sort of a new way of reasoning that has been developing. Now, what's the short-term effect? I think, well, this is a clear reaffirmation of precedent, of predictability, stability. We know what to expect with necessity, namely it's a narrow interpretation. And for environmental law, it is at least positive that the importance of this societal value of clean energy production was accepted. Now, the justification failed because it failed on the extent to which the measures contributed to the goal and the restrictive impact, whether that was really necessary on trade. Now, the panel said that it had insufficient information to decide on less trade-distorting alternatives, so I was not entirely happy with their analysis there. But India clearly will have to bring its solar program into conformity. I don't think that is such a big deal, actually, because since the US request for consultations, India has been proactively reducing its domestic content requirements. Also, at the recent Paris Climate Change Conference, India proposed the International Solar Alliance as a collaborative platform of 120 countries, and it presented its own goal of by 2022 to have 100 gigawatt solar power. If you look at that goal, and of course it's a very ambitious goal, India might not make it, the panel report would only affect about 0.5% of this whole program that India at least proposes to undertake. In terms of a mid or long-term effect, I do think there are some risks that this sets a precedent for the implementation of domestic environmental policies. With regard to the US and Japan, they do agree that these goals are important, but they are very much against any kind of discrimination, and the arguments, of course, are there that it makes solar power more expensive, less efficient, so that it's actually counterproductive from a perspective of green power. Now, what I personally was wondering about is this also highlighted, if you look at the US own experience with domestic solar programs, that they might have a very big problem at home with very similar initiatives. But I think what India and most third-party observers, in addition to green goals, were also worried about, including the EU countries, is that they did not want to substitute one very strongly concentrated market, which is currently fossil fuels, for another one. And that does not seem to have been an argument for Japan, although Japan at this point is very much dependent on Chinese solar panels. But essentially what India tried to do was, with one measure, has achieved two goals, both sustainable development and energy security, and that clearly is not working. Alternatives, well, the US has already raised a couple, the panel has to some extent discussed them, but alternatives would be to have separate measures that serve each goal. On the one hand, you could enhance domestic capabilities through tax breaks, direct subsidies, etc. And on the other hand, you could promote green energy in a variety of ways. So I will quickly move to performance requirements in investment law. And some of you might say, well, yes, but this is different applicable law, different parties, etc. But yes, you have the same facts leading to disputes. Very similar, performance requirements are sort of carrots and sticks. Carrots for market admission, it's the other way around. The benefits are the carrots. I mixed those up. I'm not particularly keen on carrots. So early investment treaties didn't even deal with this, so there was no specific provision for this. Pre-admission use of performance requirements was allowed, even if it was discriminatory. It's only post-admission that it could be seen as a violation of national treatments. And so there you also see the analysis of the panel report that could be important with regard to the interpretation of these early treaties, which are still in force often. There was also a number of treaties that have what is called an application of other rules clause, saying that investors can look beyond the borders of their own treaty. And then the question is, could an investor, for example, invoke TRIMS? It's never been tried. There are many arguments in favor or against. Now, that has already, or these treaties have been succeeded by five categories of treaties. Firstly, there are treaties that say, well, we do the same, we prohibit the same as set forth in TRIMS, the same kind of domestic content requirements. Then there's another, a next generation treaty that says, well, yes, we prohibit that, and in addition, we have a general prohibition on all post-admission performance requirements. The next generation will say, well, we do all of that, plus we have an exhaustive positive list of prohibitions. Everything that is listed is prohibited. Other things are allowed. But that is both pre- and post-admission, so yet again more extensive. And then fourthly, we also have categories 1, 2, and 3, plus a prohibition on non-compulsory treaties. So those are the carrots. So not even compulsory performance requirements, but also voluntary ones are prohibited. And then you see also that a number of reservations are put forward. And then finally, current treaties, category 5, is all of the previous, plus it's applicable to all investors. So investment treaties usually are bilateral. These treaties go beyond that and say, well, you can't have performance requirements whether they're compulsory or not, for anyone, so also investors from third countries. But those treaties then also have a very extensive list of exceptions, mostly for the public interest. So how has this panned out in case law? Well, you've had cases based on NAFTA, so the North American Free Trade Agreement, Chapter 11 on investment, and cases based on the Energy Charter Treaty. And the kind of claims you see are mostly, they can be divided in opposition, which is mostly the NAFTA claims, and actually investors claiming in favor of performance requirements. So you can have arbitrary and discriminatory state conduct claims, impermissible domestic content requirements, irregularities in how you deal with this program. And if we're going to have this program, then at least you should not suddenly or in a discriminatory manner change it. So that would be a violation of legitimate expectations or investors. If you're thinking of investment cases, well, for example, mobile investments against Canada, that's a case that where the investor won, and more precisely, 17.3 million, Canadian dollars. Interestingly, one of the panel members, so one of the investment arbitrators, was Merritt Jenner, who some of you might know as a former appellate body member here at the WTO. And that gives you also an idea of these cases are linked, if not by applicable law, at least by mindset. And then two cases are pending, another one against Canada and one that was initiated quite recently by TransCanada versus the US. So the first case is against the US about the Keystone Pipeline, which is a highly politicized project in the US. Now, what do we see here more in Europe? The Energy Charter Treaty, there's just been an explosion of cases, 29 against Spain alone. And they relate not so much against the imposition of performance requirements, but against the withdrawal or the change of the feed-in programs, tariff programs. Why have these programs been changed? Well, everybody was in favor of green energy up to the point that either the financial crisis hit or the European Commission said they were not allowed to do it because it was illegal state aid. And then on the one hand, you had this whole argument, well, but this is a voluntary domestic policy, with investors saying, no, this is a concrete promise. So we have invested in green energy on this basis, we otherwise would not have invested. So what might have originally been a voluntarily imposed domestic policy has now become a binding agreement. All these cases are pending, except for one, Charan versus Spain. Spain has won that case last January. But that is because many of these cases, it depends a bit on how sudden, how drastic the change is. So the earlier cases were much more limited, so the chances that the later cases the investors will win are much higher. And also, under the commission system, if you have received illegal state aid, you have to pay it back. And that is something that a lot of investors will also think as well, that's more than one bridge too far. Everybody then wonders, well, what about TPP? What about TTIP? These are clearly treaties in the fifth category. They do attempt to reconcile. I think I have one slide after this one. They do attempt to reconcile economic and climate policies, but for starters, there's no reference to climate change. I was told that was because otherwise it would have not ever gone through the US Congress. There is a reference to the right to regulate specific sensitive sectors like transport. So you could, bring in somehow renewable energy or carbon emissions under that flag. And there's a reference to measures protecting the environment and public welfare. But there's very few concrete measures. So there were a couple discussed, for example, trade barriers based on the product's carbon content or carbon emissions in the manufacturing process or service performance has not made it. There's some reference to incentivation schemes, but they're voluntary, flexible mechanisms, for example, to share information, or the TTIP calls them voluntary sustainability assurance schemes. But of course, it very much remains to be seen. These treaties are not in force, although, of course, TPP has been signed now. Then finally, the right and possibly also the duty to regulate. Well, if governments are serious about this Paris Agreement, the national emissions reduction targets to limit global temperature to an increase of max 2%, they will have to do something about it. My personal view would be that insofar as current rules are concerned, the WTO rules suffice to accommodate climate change mitigation policies. The only thing that has to be taken care of is that it's not disguised protectionism, but I would say with a broader interpretation of the current rules, broader in particularly in Article 20D, and possibly bringing it under 20G, that should be possible. Often this is pitched as a debate between public and private interests. I think that is wrong. I think it's more that you can get private interests on board as long as you obey the duty to regulate in a stable, transparent manner. And what about concerning future rules? Well, I think it's very bad to pitch voluntary versus binding commitments. Any adjudicatory body will always let the binding commitments prevail. So, one hand, you could have new environmental agreements, this time with binding obligations that are incorporated in domestic laws and regulations. So then you would have legally enforceable rules of conduct under domestic legal system rather than general objectives. The question is this desirable? Will you not be more fragmenting the whole system and sort of aiming for real conflicts of norms? My solution would be, wouldn't it be better to regulate this together in one legal instrument that could possibly be under the WTO aegis, but I think that's a bit too ambitious. I think it would be possible to start with these partnership agreements and really reconcile these both green and economic goals in the same document in a way that clearly makes them both binding and allows adjudicatory bodies to also give them both equal weight. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, Freya, for all these insights. It's given us a lot to think about. I'd now like to give the floor to William. It's all yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me. I feel somewhat of an outsider. I'm neither a trade expert nor a lawyer, so I come to this from the outside of this debate, trying to, I guess, locate the discussion a little bit within the energy policy context and explore a little bit more this idea about whether there's a rationale for India to sort of enter into the PV manufacturing market. So I'm going to give a little bit of an overview of the of that market. These are the three areas I'm going to try to cover. Quick overview of the global solar industry value chain for PV. Look at some of the arguments around green jobs, quick overview of that whole debate. And then try to address some of the sort of key issues around, you know, is there really a strategic issue, reason for India to enter this market? Just in terms of where PV is being installed, you probably may not be able to see the numbers here, but it's growing. This is why people get excited about it. There's 40 gigawatts installed in 2014. That puts into some perspective India's aim for 100 gigawatts. You know, it's a large number by global standards. So this is a big deal. Currently, India is on this map. This is where India's here. So they're small at the moment, but if they get anywhere near 100 gigawatts, then this is going to be big. They'd be the biggest one on that chart. So this is pretty big stuff. Just looking at the solar value chain, though, the key question for me is not whether India should be putting in solar panels or not. That's a sort of a climate and energy policy set of discussions. The key question here is whether they need to be making them themselves. So just thinking back up that value chain for the PV sector. Essentially, this is kind of what needs to be done to make a solar panel. You start upstream producing the raw feedstock, then there's the whole manufacturing of the panels, and then the downstream installation. The structure of that industry changes as you go down that value chain. So currently, the names, which you probably can't read along the bottom, these are individual companies here. Okay, so this is a really concentrated industry. Like, there's five big companies. I've put the countries where those companies are located in bigger font, so you can see what those are. when you get into the manufacturing end of things, there's some distinction between cells and modules. Often companies will make both cells and modules, but will have different amounts of capacity for each, and will buy cells from each other to make the modules, so their capacity can vary. But when you look at the modules, this is the capacity breakdown for 2014, and you can see it's much more diversified. These elements of the pie chart are by country, so it's more diversified than it shows here. And the top 15 PV modules manufacturers take up about 50% of the market. I think the other kind of really important thing to mention, though, is that the downstream end is much more diversified. This is where the PV panels actually get installed and the projects get implemented. So, just from a green jobs kind of argument point of view, I think it's really worth bearing in mind that 2/3 at least of the jobs in the solar sector are in that downstream end. So this is a whole load of companies who are either developing solar farms or installing solar panels on people's roofs or selling solar lanterns, etc. Just looking at the capacity in the market, it's kind of hard to measure because people tend to double count between modules and cells. But if you roughly look at the some figure around the middle of that lot, so probably somewhere around 50 to 55 gigawatts is the generation, is the production capacity. And this 40 gigawatts was this bumper year that we saw in 2014. So we saw this huge year in 2014 against something like 50% overcapacity, maybe a bit less than 50% overcapacity. So it's and that's partly, you know, we've seen a huge crash in the prices, and this is kind of what's going on in a lot of discussion around consolidation in the market because of overcapacity. There's a jobs breakdown. I won't go into this in too much detail. There's too many numbers on here, but there's quite a lot of jobs, but the numbers, so the biggest one is China. There's 3 million. This is from a REN 21 report I've referenced here, so you can look this up. India's on the map with 400,000 jobs. Europe is somewhere around the million mark. So pretty sizable numbers, but not kind of world dominating, but this is still a small industry by kind of global trade standards. I'll come back to that in a minute. Just looking very briefly at the evidence around green jobs arguments. This is gross jobs. That means the number of jobs you actually create by installing and operating different power generation. And again, you probably can't read the axis here, but essentially this end of the spectrum here is renewable energy sources. PV is kind of there. And fossil fuels are down to the left-hand side of this chart. So just on a very rough basis, there's pretty good evidence. This is from a literature review of lots of different studies. And that's why there's such a range on the bars, because people have different ways of estimating these. But broadly speaking, it's true that in terms of gross jobs, that renewables tend to be more labour-intensive than fossil fuels. So in a very narrow sense, you can create jobs by installing renewables. Obviously, the situation is more complex than that, because there are knock-on effects to the rest of the economy. And you not only create jobs, but you can also destroy jobs, not just by displacing power from, you know, you'll be displacing power from brown fuels effectively to the green fuels, but also knock-on effects in terms of labour market impacts. You're stealing electronic engineers from other sectors, raising labour prices and so on. And if you raise energy prices, then that will have a knock-on effect on the economy and could actually destroy more jobs than you create. It's a huge amount of disagreement in this area about, you know, how big the green job impacts are. You'll find as many arguments as there are economists about whether it's a positive or negative net effect. I think there's a reasonable amount of evidence to show in a restricted set of circumstances, particularly around investment in under times of recession, that you can create jobs. And there's a paper I'd refer to here which shows some evidence in the EU. So I would say there is evidence around, you know, a sort of a strategic reason to want to create jobs, and some evidence that you can do so. It's not particularly strong evidence, but I think it is positive. I guess the question that leads to, though, is given that two-thirds of the jobs are in the downstream installation sector, why enter the upstream market, especially when it's oversupplied and panels are, you know, currently potentially cheaper than they cost to make? So on the left-hand side are some sort of theoretical reasons why you might want to enter a particular market. Excess profits, if you think current providers are making excess profits. Is there a competitive advantage that you have? Or, on the other hand, is there a strategic threat? I think, basically, you can read my current reading of those either threats or opportunities now. I don't think there's a strong reason now. I don't see large strategic opportunities, either in terms of being able to cut costs. India doesn't particularly have a strong record in the electronics sector. Balanced against that, I would say the one strong element, competitive advantage India does have, is its huge size and its potential for a domestic market. And out of all the other countries in the world that don't have a solar PV industry, India's probably one of, you know, the one country you can think of which is big enough to kind of do that. And you look at China and you think, well, it used its domestic market very constructively to help it build that sector. So could India do the same thing? So I think that's probably the one area where there potentially is a strategic advantage. I would just point to the fact that PV is not oil. If you cut off the supply of solar panels, you don't destroy the economy within 3 months, which is what happens if your oil supply gets cut off. You know, it's a stock item, it's not a flow item. So in terms of energy security, it's a very different type of argument. The other point about strategic threats is exposure to volatile prices, but that applies whether you're a producer or an importer or an exporter. You know, if you invest big in this and the prices collapse, then you're in trouble. So very briefly, it doesn't seem to me right now there are strong strategic reasons to enter this market, but this is a dynamic market, and you should be planning decades ahead. And solar could become potentially orders of magnitude bigger than it is today if things, you know, if the climate change agenda gets taken as seriously as it should. I think I'm not going to go through this in much detail, but if India does enter, there's a whole set of considerations it needs to address, which go way beyond just local content provision. I mean, this is sort of trying to build an international industry. I'm going to finish with two very brief overviews of someone else's work. This is a referral to a report done by McKinsey on Indian manufacturing sectors. It does actually include electronics as a sort of subsidiary. This bottom section here is sectors that India could potentially have a sort of supporting role, if you like, probably not a world-leading role, as is in their view. But a number of areas. India is the blue line, and the world kind of average is the green line. And essentially what they're trying to measure here is kind of what the gap is between generally India's manufacturing capacity and skills and quality relative to kind of international, relative to its peers. And they're pointing out a number of areas where there's quite a lot of gaps. So this would also apply to the PV sector. Should it want to enter this market, it would have to address these issues. So I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Great. William, thank you so much for this excellent breakdown of the global energy context. We're now going to connect to Aaron Cosby, who, as I mentioned before, is joining us online. So just please bear with us. We're connecting him now to just take a few brief moments. Okay. We have Aaron. Aaron, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I should ask, can you hear me okay?
Yes, Aaron, we're good. For the people in the room, the black little earbuds are useful for hearing him.
Good. And I should also ask if you can see me, because if you can, I won't do anything embarrassing.
right, Aaron, you're good to go.
All right, thanks. I'll very quickly, the advantage of going last on a panel like this is that all the good stuff has already been said. So I have the luxury of basically picking a couple of interesting issues and talking about them. I'll talk briefly about one piece of this panel report that I think is troubling, and that is what it means for sustainable government procurement. And then I'll think a little bit more broadly about how this panel is situated in the broader universe of the relationship between trade and investment law and green industrial policy. I should stop at this point just to check you can hear me and see the screen okay.
Yes, Aaron, you're all good. We can hear you and your slides work great.
Very good. So on the subject of sustainable government procurement, sustainable public procurement, this is a big deal as a tool in the toolkit of countries that are trying to fulfill their Paris obligations, the Paris Agreement obligation, and UNFCCC obligations. Procurement is something like 12% of GDP in the OECD countries, up to 30% in developing countries. So a powerful tool to try to transform markets. That as a background to what this panel report says about the availability of government procurement as a tool in that box. The panel, as Jan said, found, following the appellate body in Canada Renewables, that the government procurement derogation in GATT 38A was not available. It's my opinion that the appellate body in Canada Renewables got that question quite wrong. The 38A derogation was designed to provide shelter for government procurement policies that disadvantage foreign producers, whether or not the disadvantaged good was the same as the good procured. And we can see that intent in the broad wording of 38A. It covers laws, regulations, or requirements governing the procurement. It does not just cover the act of procurement, the act of purchase. If those laws, regulations, or requirements mandate discrimination in the sense of Article 3 or 4, then that discrimination should be pardoned under 38A, whether or not the affected goods is being procured. Now, the panel in Canada Renewables, I think, got this question quite right. It made the same argument that I've just made. That was overturned by the appellate body in that case, who ruled rather that it was required in the context of Article 3, which talks about discrimination between like goods or goods in a competitive relationship, that AA would only cover this limited scope. I think that's wrong, and the final result is that you have a quite diminished ability for public procurement to green up. And the final analysis, where this panel leaves us is any sustainable procurement policy is going to be an investment measure. This is a broad interpretation of what an investment measure is. It dates back to the Indonesia Autos case. It was referenced in Canada Renewables and referenced against here. Any such policy that has domestic content requirements attached is going to be a trade-related investment measure. This is fairly straightforward because it affects trade. If that policy focuses on the inputs, if the discriminatory element in that policy focuses on the characteristics of the inputs, as it did in this case, it will not be saved by GATT Article 38A. What does that mean? In the first case, two implications. We have less policy space than was intended by the drafters of the GATT, in my view. The 38A is intended to allow broad leeway for government procurement measures to be discriminatory, including by invoking domestic content requirements. This is allowed under 38A. But if they do so by describing the inputs that are producing the goods in question, this panel says that 38A does not cover them. I think that's arguably incorrect. More broadly, it may cover some, there's some fundamental uncertainty left by this panel and by the AB and Canada Renewables as to whether broader forms of sustainable public procurement are allowed. In the AB and Canada Renewable, the panel did not rule on whether it was allowable to focus on inputs or processes in the context of discriminatory public procurement. They didn't feel it was necessary to rule on that. Neither did the panel in this case, because they cited the fact that the material facts of this case were so similar to the Canada Renewables case, there was no need to go into that. So we're left with some uncertainty as to whether government procurement can be discriminatory in terms of its description of how a good is produced and what inputs are used in the production of that good. This, in my opinion, is an unwelcome bit of uncertainty. Next, to talk about green industrial policy more broadly. As Jan said, the ruling in this case was, you know, in English vernacular, we would say it was a slam dunk. It's quite clear that this particular set of measures was going to be found to be in breach of GATT obligations. We do not permit domestic content requirements. It's quite clearly set out in the TRIMS illustrative list of policies which breach GATT 3.4. But the question is then, are those rules appropriate? Keep in mind that we're trying to, as a global community of countries, achieve the Paris outcome targets of a 2% increase in global average temperatures by 2050, and we're striving to get even lower than that. We're talking here about a scale of transformation of our economies and of our societies, not really seen outside of the experience of the Industrial Revolution, but unlike the Industrial Revolution, sandwiched into a period of only a couple of decades. It's a massive, massive transformation. And so policymakers are really looking for any tool at their disposal to help achieve that kind of transformation. So the question is, are the rules of the WTO that prevent domestic content requirements appropriate? And of course, we're talking not only in that context of this wider discussion about the TRIMS agreement, but also about the subsidy agreement, which was relevant in the Canada Renewables case. We are also talking, as Freya Bacon said, not just about WTO law, but about investment law, about the thousands of international or bilateral investment treaties out there, and more recently, the investment agreements within investment chapters within trade agreements. All of which contain, or sorry, not all of which, but the more modern ones of which contain prohibitions on performance requirements that were so well described in Freya's presentation. So the question then, in the context of all of that, is should members be allowed, in an ideal world, would members be allowed to use domestic content requirements to pursue their environmental and economic goals simultaneously? The green economy movement spearheaded by UNEP is, of course, a commitment by governments to achieve both of these goals at the same time. Problematic under trade law, but that's what it's about. There's no primacy of achieving the economic goal or the environmental goal. They're designed to be achieved simultaneously. Here I'm going to take a little side trip to just look at the difference between green industrial policy and traditional industrial policy. The reason industrial policy traditionally cast is so abhorrent to trade policy community is that if it's properly achieved, it's basically a mercantilist instrument. The benefits are all vested domestically and the costs all vest internationally. You displaced foreign imports with your own competitive industries. In fact, you've started exporting from those industries. One salient difference in the context of green industrial policy is that if it is successful in its goals, the benefits are not just domestic. If, for example, China has successfully created a domestic manufacturing capacity in solar, and the presentation by William makes it quite clear that they have done this, And therefore, the prices of solar panels dropped by something like 75% over the last year and last 5 years, and they have done that. The benefits of that are not just vesting with China, they're globally vested. You can calculate those benefits in terms of additional capacity to mitigate climate change internationally. And climate change being, as I said before, an overriding challenge, those benefits are significant, and more significant than they would be in the case of a country which succeeded in exporting better widgets and lower priced widgets. So back to the question, should countries be allowed to use domestic content requirement? This is an economic, in my view, an economic question. It rests on the answer to the question whether they are in fact effective. Can they achieve their stated aims? Industrial policy and domestic content requirements as an element of industrial policy has a checkered history throughout economics literature, and for the most part, they don't succeed. But the message of the more recent reading is that they can work under the right circumstances. If they are put in place not as a single piece of legislation, but as a piece of a complementary web of measures that include capacity building for the suppliers, financing support, infrastructure, these types of things, that's a good indicator. If they're applied to sectors where there is a sufficient capacity actually to jump to a globally competitive state and not where there is simply no capacity there, then that is another indication of success. If they're put in place conditional on performance and withdrawn when that performance is not achieved within a certain amount of time, if the goal is finally and clearly enunciated as the ability to become globally competitive, that is also another indication of success. And of course, the standard caveats about the need for full communication between private and public sector, full transparency to prevent corruption and rent seeking. All of these conditions are important elements of success for green industrial policy and domestic content requirements more specifically. But of course, that's a very demanding set of conditions for success, and particularly demanding in the context of developing countries, which have more limited capacity and resources to administer these kinds of tools. And if they are unsuccessful, domestic content requirements actually work against both the environment and the economy. They drive up the price of the purchased goods and make it more expensive to achieve environmental quality. So finally, this is an important question to get right. Do they work? From an environmental perspective, if they work, they create, in the first instance, new innovative industries which can add to the stock of urgently needed green technologies, which drive down the price of production of those technologies. This is an important contribution to the fight against climate change. They may also provide political space, and this is quite a separate argument, provide the political space for government to implement environmental measures. And this was referenced by a couple of the other presenters before me. It may be, and it has been argued, that we should allow these kinds of imperfect measures because without them, governments would be unable to put in place costly environmental policies. This was certainly the case in Ontario, in Canada. We would never have been able to put in place its phase out of coal and its phase in of renewables without promising the jobs that might be wrong with it. It's questionable whether that's a justifiable rationale, especially from a trade policy perspective, but it is a palpable environmental impact. It's not only important to get this right in the context of green goods and climate change, but also important to get it right in the context of development. The Sustainable Development Goals call for sustainable industrialization precisely because that kind of industrialization is a driver of development and poverty alleviation, if it's done correctly. So we're talking not just about an environmental issue here, but also fundamentally an economic development issue. And as I said before, this is an important question, not just for WTO law, but also for regional trade agreements, for international investment agreements, and within WTO law, not just for trims, but also for subsidy law. I don't have an answer to those questions. In the final event, the really important questions are, first, if it is possible to use domestic content requirements effectively, even if it's very difficult to get it right, is it appropriate to prohibit it? So is it appropriate to say to India, we don't think you're going to be able to do this stuff right because you have a corrupt bureaucracy and these are imperfect instruments and they're really hard to get right, therefore we're just going to prohibit it? Is that appropriate, or should we be allowing states to try and possibly fail as we do with other areas of public policy? An open question. Is there any way within WTO law or trade law or investment law to allow domestic content requirements but to discipline their use so as to favor their success? Could we say can we take lessons from the history of industrial policy more broadly and how to do it right and how to do it wrong and say, for example, there must be a time limitation on your support for these infant industries and this sort of thing? Again, these are open questions. It's not clear to me what the answers are, but the answers are fundamentally important as we go forward with trying to achieve the commitments the countries undertook under the Paris Agreements and the much-needed development that's spoken of in the Sustainable Development Goals. This particular case is a sort of a microcosm of the greater tension between those issues felt at the space of green industrial policy, trade and investment law. It follows, obviously, on the Canada Renewables case in that respect, and therefore interesting to talk about, even if I admit the practical possibility of changing WTO law at this point is remote. I'll leave it with that. Thank you.
Great. Aaron, thank you so much. These are very interesting questions to think about, and as you rightly noted, very complex. What we'd now like to do is, now we've had all of our presentations, is give each speaker a few minutes to comment on what each other has said, just 2 or 3 minutes each, and we'll keep the same speaking order as we had before. So we'll start with Jan and go from there. Jan, the floor is yours.
Great. Thank you. I don't really have so much in terms of comments rather than questions. I think those have been very interesting interventions by my co-panelists. And perhaps I would ask a question to Aaron and to William. I also have many questions for Freya, but in the interest of time, I'll just focus on Aaron and William. So for Aaron, I thought it was interesting your critique of the appellate body's case law under 3.8, and you're saying, well, this product limitation is perhaps not entirely appropriate, and sort of then the nexus should be relaxed. But even if one does that, there are sort of other conditions under Article 3.8. There is the fact that these products shall not be used for commercial resale. They should be used by the government, either in-house, as it were, or for some narrowly defined governmental purpose. And so even if one were to revert to what the panel said in Canada feed-in tariffs, there would still be all these other hurdles. And if you remove those hurdles, isn't there too much then of a loophole in the 3.8? I mean, the government essentially here in this case was working as an intermediary, both in this case and in Canada feed-in tariffs. And the energy was being resold sort of on a commercial basis, arguably. And so I was wondering about your thoughts on that. And then the second question, and perhaps that goes to the rest of the panel in a way, is there enough in WTO law for industrial policy? Is there enough flexibility already? And I mean, governments do a lot of industrial policy around the world. There's a huge proliferation of local content requirements. What we see here, that's just sort of one example. And presumably the reason why the U.S. went after this is because they had a strong commercial interest, because it's a huge market. But there's many smaller markets that perhaps fly under the radar, or where local content requirements or many industrial policy measures fly under the radar. And there, you know, you can lots of flexibility in terms of subsidies. And think of the alternatives that the United States proposed in this case. I was just wondering your thoughts on whether the flexibility that already exists is not enough. and whether it would really be worth taking the risk of relaxing the disciplines by allowing, you know, departure from national treatment, which is a bedrock principle of this organization. Is this something that is worth risking, given perhaps the already existing flexibility? Is it necessary? I think sort of India's argument here was, look, yeah, the rich countries can subsidize, but we can't. So sort of we have to use these local content requirements. Is this sort of, would you consider this to be valid, or my co-panelists as well? And the question I had for William, I thought was interesting. I mean, one of the many things that India said in this case is that we have to foster this domestic production capacity of solar cells and solar panels because, you know, we could have supply could be disrupted and then we can't properly produce solar electricity and then satisfy all these goals, including climate change objectives. And you spoke about the industry, and I thought it was really interesting is how highly concentrated that industry is. And you spoke about the currently extremely low prices and sort of the price swings. And that was one of the things that India was speaking about. Do you think is this industry sort of particularly, is this an example of an industry where it makes particular sense to foster domestic production capacity? Or is it like any other? Did India here have a point at a policy level? I don't mean at a legal level, but is there sort of a particular reason? Does this make more sense in this industry than in another because of the structure of the industry and the way the supply chain works?
Thank you. I had some more comments based on what Aaron said, based on what Jan said as well about this government procurement derogation. And so the panel said, well, the two are not in a competitive relationship. He has obviously not the different things. And it's not because you buy the milk that you're also buying the cow. But I do wonder whether that interpretation was not simply too narrow, because definitely at consumer level today, I think that these are to some extent in competitive relationship, because people do consider whether to buy their own solar panels or, you know, replace their purchases from the grid. So I wonder whether it would be possible to have a bit more broad interpretation. Because if you follow the panel's decision, for example, were India to build solar plants itself, so to directly buy as a government, buy these cells and these modules, then it would be directly procuring the equipment. But isn't that pushing a country towards nationalizing a sector, which I thought, you know, we all wanted to get away from? And then, okay, you still have this hurdle about commercial sale, but just imagine they would, for example, sell it at cost again, so that it would be a break-even situation. I think that is very, very undesirable. But I would like to briefly answer the last question Aaron raised and the one of the questions that you had. So should we discipline domestic content requirements so as to, you know, make sure that there are those that where it is possible that it is successful? Well, I think it's hard to speculate with regard to two treaties, the TPP and the TTIP, that are not yet in force. But I think definitely governments are trying to, these treaties reflect an attempt to try to do exactly this. If you look at these provisions, sort of the positive list and then the list with exceptions, you're talking about, you know, 3-4 pages just with examples. So I think that is exactly what, I mean, they're trying to answer your last question. And is there enough flexibility already? Well, my simple answer would be yes. I think the current rules are perfectly sufficient, but it should be the mindset of those that interpret the rules that should be a bit broader than what was the case here.
Great. Thanks, Freya. Go ahead, William.
Thank you. I hesitate to ask questions on the legal side of things. I'll restrict my comments to trying to answer Jan's question about the particular reason for this industry. I mean, it's interesting. I guess you can sort of try to characterize the PV debate as it sits somewhere on the spectrum between. It's not oil, right? Which is the point I made before. Does that mean it basically PV is just like mobile phones and other consumer electronics? And, you know, why would you, as a country, want to enter a consumer electronics? People don't worry about the security of supply of mobile phones. So is a PV panel just like a mobile phone, or is it like oil? I think right now it looks much more like a mobile phone than it does look like an oil product. Having said that, if it does take off, like the point I was making before was, if you know, when you look at the scale of the transformation of the energy sector that Aaron was pointing out, it's vast. And when you look at the size of the energy sector right now, it's kind of 10%. Other people probably know this number better than I do. But it's of the order of 10% of total global trade. It's absolutely vast. Assuming that oil gets replaced with something else and coal gets replaced with something else and that solar becomes part of that, it's going to be big. And in that context, that makes it stop looking a bit like mobile phones and spreads it into something that looks a bit more like energy. But so I guess it is. But I still wouldn't say that there's an immediate kind of need, even in that context, to have your own domestic capacity for the whole product. I think what will happen as the industry grows is that the sector will become more complex, more diversified in terms of where the components are actually produced, more specialised. These will all, as you see the cost driving down, that's what's happened in all the other products, that you find specialist producers for individual components spreading out more widely across the world, and then they'll come back together again in the final place where the things get assembled. So I see the supply chain getting more diversified and complex, and you maybe want to pick off, you know, one or two or three of those particular bits. That's where the strategy will be. The other thing to bear in mind is that we're currently talking about crystalline silicon as, you know, the dominant technology. That's not necessarily going to be the case, you know, as the century unfolds. So I think we might look back on where we are now and see this as a bit of a dinosaur technology. Who knows where we're going to be in kind of 10, 20 years' time when this really is kicking off big time.
Thanks, William. Aaron, please go ahead.
Thank you. The advantage of going last is that I'm not really going to ask questions of the other panelists. They won't have a chance to respond, so I'll just respond to the ones that have been raised. To follow up on William's last point, it's quite right. We're not just talking about solar panels here. These policy discussions are relevant to the technologies of the future. So if you think the world's global trade in solar panels is big, it's nothing compared to the global trade in automobiles. And we are going to see in the next 25 years a complete replacement of the internal combustion engine with electronic vehicles. That's going to be the subject of intense government support, because the automobile sector always has been. It has these spin-off manufacturing benefits. And so it's important to get the rules right at this point, because there's going to be much more important disputes coming. To pick up on Freya's point about the development in some of the regional trade agreements, she's quite right. The policy space for this stuff is being closed quite quickly. Again, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but if you look at the CETA, the Canada-Europe trade agreement, it's quite restrictive in terms of industrial policy. No technology transfer, no joint venture requirements, no domestic content requirements. There's quite a list of prohibitions on these kinds of performance requirements. And this seems to be the trend. Whether that trend is the right way to go or not is, as I say, the open question. And this brings me to Jan's question about whether the existing flexibilities are adequate within WTO law. And I would broaden that to ask about other forms of investment law and regional trade agreements. Really, for me, I think there's a need to distinguish between the environmental motivations here and traditional industrial policy. As I said, there is a difference. So if we look, for example, at subsidies, we take it back to Canada Renewables. The subsidies being objected to in Canada Renewables were subsidies which were actually market-correcting subsidies. They're trying to internalize an environmental externality and bring into greater coherence with social value the price being offered to that electricity. That's quite a different proposition from market-distorting subsidies that are usually the subject of complaints under the ASCM. And surely we need to find a way to differentiate between those two, whether it's in the determination of benefit or some other point in the test of what is and is not a subsidy. But I think the flexibility needs to be there to allow for those subsidies, which are in fact market correcting subsidies. That flexibility does not currently exist within the SCM. Further, I think it's a mistake, in my view, for the flexibility for government procurement to be closed down as it is being in the current agreement on government procurement, which for those signatories to the agreement allows for absolutely no offsets. Domestic content requirements being one example of an offset. This closes off the flexibility for these kinds of requirements that currently exists within the GATT agreement, and I think unfortunately so. But we're talking here about a limited market. This is not as market distorting as it might be if it were applied otherwise, but I think an important point. And then to come back to Jan's first question about the other aspects of Article 3.8a, I should have made clear when I was critiquing the interpretation of 3.8a, I quite agree that India's purchase of electricity was for commercial resale. This was not government procurement. So if I sound like I'm defending India on the grounds of government procurement, I am not. My concern is that if, hypothetically, India changed its procurement policies and said, we are going to procure electricity for the military only. The military is a big consumer of electricity. We're going to consume it for our own consumption, that is proper government procurement. They would still be caught by this interpretation of Article 3.8a. They would still be unable to do that, and that's my concern. I completely understand and sympathize with the rest of the elements of 3.8a, and I don't pretend to sympathize with either India or Canada on the grounds that what they were doing was actual government procurement, because it wasn't.
Okay, thanks so much, Aaron and everyone, for these really interesting comments. It's now time to open things up to audience participation, so this gives you all the chance to ask any questions you have or give any comments. What we'll do is I'll collect three or four questions, then our speakers will have a chance to respond. We can then do a second, third round, et cetera, as time allows. For our audience participants, please make sure to use the microphone in front of you when you're speaking, and speak as clearly as you can, especially for our audience online. And please also state your name and affiliation as you take the floor. And feel free to either raise your hands or raise the flags on your table. Hannes, we can start with you.
Hannes Schlimmann of WT Advisors. Thank you so much. I think this is seriously enriching stuff. I had a question to Jan and Freya, or actually everyone on the panel. We've now got Paris, and under Paris we got not INDCs, but NDCs. In fact, we've got the first one, I think, out from Papua New Guinea, of all places. And so we have a progressively more binding situation of sorts. And I was wondering where you think NDCs, I think it might also depend on the formulation, but NDCs in a system where international treaties have direct effect of sorts, where NDCs would then fall? Because at some point an NDC could be formulated in a way where an argument could be made that we are looking at a situation where Article 20D could be invoked. Would you agree with that? And second, just by way of semantics, William, I thought when you used the phrase as the century unfolds, I felt that's exactly where we are. The century is unfolding, and we're looking at the electric cars and all those technology changes, and we have no idea where it's going. So I have big sympathy with the arguments that you prepared and Aaron put out. I think the situation, the whole assessment of subsidies and their role in economic policy making has been reassessed anyway implicitly after the financial crisis, where we had an absolute rampant use of subsidies of sorts, and no one went to the SCM agreement. And obviously the perennial question always is, can we revive Article 8 of the SCM agreement somehow and make it allow us to do what we need to do? Thank you.
Thanks, Hannes. Let's see, other questions? And for those in the back, please raise your hands high so I can see you. Okay, well, we also have a few people who've sent in questions online, people from the floor. And we have one person who's asked how LCRs can be effective, and from an economic perspective, does it make any difference if it is a big country or a small country imposing LCRs? And even if certain LCRs can be legitimized, how can a policymaker differentiate what should be legitimized and what should not in light of countries' differences, as mentioned earlier? So that's one question submitted through the ICTSD website by Lily Brown. And let's see, do we have any other people who want to speak from the floor? If not, we've got one more question that's been submitted online so far. Okay, well, we've got one question online from Bahesh Sugathan, one of my ICTSD colleagues, who has noted that the fact that Article 3 and the Terms Agreement prohibit DCRs unless pertain to government procurement of the product is not in question. He says that the issue of whether these are necessary to create domestic manufacturing capacity is certainly contentious. So his question relates to the panel's conclusion while responding to India's argument under Article 20J that the risk of short supply must be imminent. However, assuming that in the event some level of domestic manufacturing capacity is definitely required to deal with such short supply, such capacity cannot surely be created overnight to respond to such eminent shortages, in such a scenario, should the, quote, eminence, unquote, aspect of short supply be reconsidered while interpreting Article 20J, particularly if important objectives such as climate change mitigation is at stake? Okay, so that's that question. So that gives us three to get started. So how about I turn it back to our panel, and they can provide some feedback on that, and then we can do another round. Thank you. We can start in the same speaking order as we've had before. So Ian, you're welcome to go first, unless someone else has a burning need to go beforehand.
I always have to go first. Okay. It's like scary blank page of paper. Hannes, I think for your question, so your question is if there's an international agreement that can be relied on under 20D because, say, it has direct effect, but that agreement actually mandates local content requirements. Is that what you're envisaging?
No, I was more general than that, because we have the national determined contributions now coming in, and they are supposed to be binding, a more binding instrument than what we had before, certainly more than the UNFCCC. We're moving in that direction now. How far we're moving, I know panels will then, you know, have to judge that in a particular case, but considering what all of you said, really, in different ways, is that, are we looking at a situation where perhaps in future it might be easier for countries to rely on 20D? And as a follow-on question, also thinking as an advisor, does that mean we should think of the way we formulate NDCs in order to basically set the stage for an Article 20D situation later?
It's just hard for me to answer a little bit in the abstract, but I suppose if international agreements sort of are more concrete, more binding, such that they then would have direct effect and said they would qualify, they could also qualify just by being transposed into domestic law. I mean, it's not that international law has to have direct effect. It could be simply transposed into a domestic legal act, and then it theoretically qualifies under 20D, and you would have to look whether it's consistent with the GATT. I think the problem with domestic content requirements simply remains that you will probably tend to find, or we probably always find, a less trade restrictive alternative. I mean, we are dealing with departures from a bedrock principle of this organization, national treatment, and the panel sort of listed all the alternatives. The U.S. listed six alternatives that were here for India, and I suppose one would always be able to, or there would be reasonable space to find alternatives to local content requirements. It's just really, really hard for me to visualize why there wouldn't be another way of going about things, pursuing environmental objectives rather than going through local content requirements. On the question about how to differentiate between good or bad policy interventions, I'm not qualified to speak, other than my personal view is that there is quite a bit of flexibility already in the agreement, as I said, not sure it exhausts all the scope of policy interventions that experts might agree upon, but I think there is a good scope of flexibility in the agreements already. On the question of 20J, I think the idea was, what if one were to agree that a risk of shortage qualifies, and so that part of 20J is satisfied. Once again, if we sort of look at this specific measure, one would still have to demonstrate that the measures here are essential to address, that short supply. And here again, we come to the questions of alternatives. Is a local content requirement really the best way to go about addressing be it an environmental goal or ensuring adequate supply? Again, the panel didn't have the opportunity to really look into these alternatives that the U.S. was putting forward. But again, the U.S. put forward six alternatives. I sort of skimmed those in my presentation, but it was removing barriers to trade and investment in solar cells or modules, stockpiling solar cells or modules, so having a sort of a strategic stockpile, kind of like what do you have in the food, right? Sort of warehouse, public food stocks, right? Debate. Entering into long-term contracts with suppliers of solar cells and modules for the government. Direct subsidization, although here, of course, India said we can't afford that. Investing in research and development, increasing domestic demand. So again, wondering to what extent these alternatives will tend to be a viable alternative to local content requirements that are just simply a big departure from what the law is today.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your question. With the Paris Agreement, I think we're definitely moving towards making things more progressively more binding. I don't think we're quite there yet to have an exact counterweight to economic obligations, but as I already said during my presentation, I think we first of all need binding obligations, but I think it's even though you can do it separately, I don't think it's a good idea to do it separately from in separate agreements from these economic treaties, because in the end you will always have a clash, and particularly as long as these environmental agreements don't really have functioning dispute settlement mechanisms, the disputes will be decided here. So you want to make sure that any panel here has a firm basis to really weigh them against each other. Now, as to think about formulation as an advisor, I would say yes, particularly not for so much from a trade perspective, because the worst thing that can happen is that you have to change your laws. But from an investment perspective, you don't want to be the advisor who, caused a $15 billion mistake. You would definitely need to bear this in mind from different perspectives, including, and perhaps most importantly, the investment perspective. If I may, I would like to abuse for 1 second to answer something to what William said. With regard to energy security, I think you're absolutely right from an academic point of view that this does not really mean that much yet. But I think from a political point of view, if you follow the debates, particularly in the EU, politicians and people in general are hugely worried. They don't want fossil fuel because they don't want to be independent, dependent on Saudi Arabia. They don't want gas because they don't want to be dependent on Russia. They don't want nuclear power because you see what happened in Fukushima. So I think there's definitely a political need, which, academically speaking, might be sometimes ridiculous, but, there are political needs that are not completely substantiated by the facts. And several countries have started reopening their power plants, for example, to even power plants that had been mothballed. That's the actual term I was told, to put them in use again. There are now court cases from German states against Belgium because they're too afraid that the power plants will cause some kind of disaster. So I think this is a very real problem, even if you say that, well, factually speaking, if you look at statistics, it doesn't really mean that much.
William, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Just briefly on that point, I mean, I wasn't wanting to make the impression that concerns about being cut off from oil were entirely irrational. What I was trying to make the point was that being cut off from supplies of solar panels looks nothing like the risk of being cut off from oil. If you have no oil into your economy collapses very rapidly. If you get cut off from the supply of solar panels,
but you can't build it that fast either.
But you don't. I mean, the point is, your solar panels that you've already got in your system carry on producing electricity. Unless you're being blocked off from the sunlight, you know, that's the equivalent of being blocked off from oil is being blocked off from the sunlight. So, if someone puts a big umbrella above your country, then that's where the risk is.
I agree there's less urgency. The only thing I was saying was, well, it's not as if, you know, if you're blocked off your solar panels, that even in 1 year you can build up this kind of industry on your own. It would take a number of years.
Right. I mean, so you're looking at the growth. I mean, you'd have a problem growing your sector. But the sector you've already got is fine. I mean, it's protected in that sense. But, I mean, it goes to the points that I think the online questioner came up with, which is about the imminent shortage question, and seen on this scale, a multi-decadal scale of how quickly this sector's growing, is the current capacity. I mean, you'd look at the current overcapacity and you'd say, this is crazy, why would you build anything? But given the scale at which it's intended to grow, I think you potentially could make the argument. I'm not in a position to know how long it takes to build these industries out, and certainly when you look upstream, you know, where the choke points are in that supply chain is another issue. I mean, it could be that you've only got five companies producing the raw material. It's a much very specialised kind of process, an expensive and really kind of expensive process, and that partly drives these fluctuations that you've seen over over decades, and you're going to see those fluctuations again unless you protect yourself completely from the industry and just try and do the whole supply chain yourself. But that's kind of not the approach most countries take in most products. So I would, and it comes back to this question, which bit of the supply chain do they feel they ought to be playing in? The other link to the question online was, does it make a difference whether you're a big country or a small country as to how you do LCRs? And it probably does. I mean, effectively, unless you're big, you'd never, I don't think, consider putting an LCR for production. I mean, it just doesn't make sense to me. What you might do is have a local content requirement for the kind of services and try to grow your local sector for actually delivering these projects. And that's certainly something I see in the kind of East African solar market. It's kind of, how do you balance the need to create local capacity versus having international companies coming in and doing it for you, even when that's down to selling, you know, just the infrastructure for selling little solar systems. And then it probably comes back again to your point about NDCs. Kind of, what does it mean then if you feel that this is an important part of your industrial strategy going forward? You know, I don't think any of us are in a position to tell what countries should be doing in terms of choosing which sectors they want to play in. I mean, that's up to them. That's their economic policy. If they want to protect, I mean, I suppose it raises a question in my mind as to whether you could build in active industrial policy around PV, for example, into your NDC, claim that that's then a binding commitment and use that as a sort of reason for then protecting the mechanisms that you've said you're going to do. Because the NDCs, as far as I understand it, they're fairly loose, but they can include mechanisms as well as kind of targets. So potentially, I don't know, where that positions it within the whole kind of relationship with trade.
Okay, Aaron, the floor is yours.
I'm going to pick up on the last point that William made with respect to the first question from Hannes Schloman. What if an NDC? Let me back up. First, I don't think Paris has actually gotten us closer to any kind of a binding international agreement. And maybe I misunderstood, but I think it moves actually further away from a binding international commitment. The Paris Agreement was a sort of a pledge and review agreement, much less binding in its impact than was, for example, the Kyoto Protocol. And in any case, we will never see at the international level a climate change agreement which specifies the types of domestic policies that the parties have to take. That will never happen. It's been studiously avoided throughout the history of the UNFCCC negotiations, from the convention stage and through all of the protocols. What we do see is agreement on broad targets. As a global community, we will try to limit global average temperature increases to 2 degrees above. That's a broad target. How that target is achieved, through what instruments, is left to be elaborated at the national level, as is appropriate, in deference to sovereign need to undertake, to assess your unique capacities and your unique needs. But we will never see anything at the international level that 20D will be able to rely on as a binding sort of a direct command. However, a question for Jan, I think. Suppose in a nationally determined commitment, I say, in achieving my UNFCCC contributions, I am going to achieve 100 gigawatts of domestically produced solar generating capacity. What if I say that? I can't imagine anybody saying that, and none of the NDCs have come close to that kind of level of specificity. But if I did, would that be a national law in the sense of 20D with direct effect? To then come to the question from Billy Brown online, yes, it matters whether you're a big country or a small country, but that's only one of the several things that matter. The primary thing that matters is what the subject of the local content requirement is. So if I'm talking about local content requirements for a manufactured good like a solar panel, it makes a huge difference. I would never advise a small country, even Canada probably isn't going to be able to pull off creating a domestic capacity in this particular space in the face of monstrous Chinese investment. So if you're a smaller country, that makes no sense. But of course, if I'm talking by contrast about a domestic content requirement that says, if you're going to come and set up a mine in the remote districts of my country, you will procure all your food locally, and you will procure, you know, your housing materials locally. That's the kind of thing that obviously even a small country should be able to provide, you know, I'm assuming some basic degree of agricultural capacity. So, I mean, you have to take into account in deciding whether these tools are appropriate or not, what is the capacity of your domestic suppliers? How close are they to being internationally competitive? So how much of a cost are you adding to the international investors that come in by forcing them to buy locally? So it's not just a matter of big or small, although that's very important, specifically in the context of something like the solar panels, because another question is, can you provide a big domestic market into which it can be sold? In the case of China, that's the answer is yes, obviously. In the case of India, the answer is yes, too. And as William said, maybe India is big enough to actually pull this off. It remains to be seen. We're not sure about that. And finally, in answer to Mahesh's question about shortage of supply, you know, the solar panels, as William said, are not oil. So there's very little possibility that you have a cartel arrangement that drives up the price and increases the scarcity of supply of solar panels. In fact, it's quite the opposite. You have a glut, an oversupply of capacity, an overcapacity in the manufacturing sector for solar modules, who would be delighted to sell to you from any number of countries. And William's pie chart showed the number of countries. The suppliers are not limited by geography, as is the case for oil or agricultural goods. The ramp-up time to production is not particularly large, as it would be in the case of oil. And there's the overriding difference is there is no urgency. As William said, if you cut off supplies of oil, you're in trouble. If you cut off supplies of food, you're in trouble. If you cut off supplies of solar panels, the installation of solar generating capacity takes place over, you know, at least a 5-year period from conception to actual coming online. It's inconceivable that during that 5-year period, you couldn't source your solar panels from one or another country that would be happy to sell them to you. So the whole idea of scarcity in this particular case seems to be clutching at straws by the Indian government that didn't have sympathetic rules to rely on and therefore had to resort to rules that really were inapplicable to the facts of the case.
Okay, thanks, Aaron. I know there are a few questions directed to some speakers throughout. Jan, I think you got a question from Aaron and possibly a few others. If anyone wants to pick up on the points that have come up over the last few minutes, please go ahead.
I think, Aaron, you asked what if there were an international agreement that said thou shalt generate 100 gigawatt of renewable energy, would that fit under 20?
Oh, no, sorry to interrupt. What if a national government said in response to my international obligations, my nationally determined contribution is going to be the generation of all this domestic capacity. There's no international obligation to be that specific. But if I enact a law at the national level that says I'm going to have all this generating capacity and it's going to be locally produced, could I fudge my national law to sound like something with which I need to comply? Well,
I'm not sure I can give clear answers here. Just sort of the ideas that come to my head is, I mean, one is this particular law regulation, is it consistent with the GATT? So that would be the starting point. Second, there's an issue as to whether the measures that are meant to ensure compliance with non-consistent laws and regulations, whose compliance are you seeking to ensure? I mean, it's questionable whether the government can be enacting measures to ensure its own compliance, and the panel raises that question in the report and doesn't answer it. But I think there's a legitimate question, because typically the people whose compliance you're seeking to ensure are private individuals or companies. It's questionable whether 20D covers sort of the government making itself comply with something, because that could be, you know, self-referential. But even if we get sort of past that, I mean, are local content requirements, is a local content requirement really necessary to actually get to, for instance, a particular capacity? Is it making a contribution? I mean, in this case, the panel sort of recites evidence that is relatively skeptical on that. What about alternative measures? I mean, one thing we sort of perhaps didn't mention, but I think it's also reflected in the panel report, is that certainly in the short run, a local content requirement is making things worse. I mean, if the idea here is sort of to have a long-term, to build domestic manufacturing capacity long-term, on the part of the solar cells and solar modules producers. But for the generators of electricity, if you impose a local content requirement, you're making things more difficult. You're cutting off their supply. So certainly in the short run, it's not clear that, you know, local content requirement is making a positive contribution. So I suppose all of these questions one would have to ask for the kind of hypothetical you just formulated. But it's a very interesting scenario.
If anyone has more comments, otherwise we'll do another round of questions from the floor. Okay, so yes, anyone in the floor, please raise your hand. Okay, over there. Floor is yours.
Thank you. My name is Madeline Dugal, and I'm an independent consultant on international trade. Thank you to all the panelists for very interesting presentations. I guess my comment and question is related mostly to what to Aaron's presentation, and it is partly been actually commented, and Jan actually, Jan's last comment actually addressed what I was actually going to say. I find it a bit disturbing as to why you consider DCRs such important tools. There appears to be absolutely no rational basis for mandatory DCRs to contribute towards the promotion of clean energy in this case, for example. The panel made it amply clear, and Jan mentioned that the ruling was against the DCR and not India's national solar program or its underlying environmental and energy security objectives. So the program can go on without the DCR. In fact, as Jan mentioned in his last comment, if India allows imports of solar cells and modules, solar power developers are free to buy inputs from the most cost-effective source. And in fact, if there are high costs involved, it might make the generation of solar energy economically unfeasible. This runs counter to India's objectives of enhancing production capacity and meeting India's energy security needs as well. I wanted to mention a point that this WTO ruling came amidst the cacophony of the current Indian government's Make in India initiative. And I wanted to make this very important point that Make in India should not become another name for reverting to pre-1991 liberalization reforms of import substitution policy in India. In fact, the success of Make in India depends on the ability of manufacturers to be able to produce goods at competitive prices. In fact, and this relates to one of the questions that Aaron raised, if barriers to trade are removed, it will actually encourage much needed both foreign and domestic investment in solar energy generation. This in turn should actually encourage investment in the manufacture, domestic investment in the manufacture of solar cells and modules. Your free play of market forces then may even lead to developers purchasing inputs from domestic manufacturers. If a lot of other alternative measures and WTO consistent measures are actually undertaken for the government to provide structural support to its domestic manufacturers to become internationally competitive. Lastly, I think we seem to forget that the WTO actually does not prevent its members from derogating from its obligations to meet a legitimate policy objective. It only restricts members' policy choices on how to achieve these goals. And the cardinal recurrent themes that have come up in these cases is, you know, the arbitrary and unjustifiable discrimination, your disguised restrictions to trade, using the least restrictive trade measure when meeting legitimate policy objectives, and definitely not pursuing trade and economic objectives in the guise of environmental objectives. Thank you.
Great, thanks very much. I'm going to give the panelists a chance to answer straight away, and I know William has to leave very shortly to catch a plane, so I'll let him go first and also give any final thoughts so he can make his plane on time. We can take other questions after.
Thank you very much. That gives me a reason to cut my comments short. I think I've made most of the points I was going to. I think you've raised a lot of interesting questions in those final comments about the impact and rationale for supporting national industries. I just wanted to finish with perhaps a wider point on the question of the relationship between climate change and trade. I mean, it's been a while since I've visited this topic, and going back a few years, the kind of debate was tended to be around Kyoto, when Kyoto was still kind of the framework, and everybody thought they were going to be legally binding top-down targets. The question was, how do you make this work? You know, these are legally binding, but what does that mean? You know, there's no teeth to this, and there was a kind of maybe a naive sort of thought that maybe the trade rules could be used to provide teeth to the climate negotiations. And now that's all under, you know, Kyoto's dead. We're in a different world. We're now in Paris, and Paris is very different. I mean, the NDCs, you're relying on countries to provide the ambition levels for themselves, and somehow you've got to encourage ambition. And I think I guess this was my sort of parting thought, was, and it's certainly way outside my area to answer the question, but, you know, could trade somehow be used to help support that process and support ambition? Because otherwise you're never going to get to the ambition levels that you need. Rather than not seeing it as a set of teeth to enforce, because if you start to put that in place now, you'll never get the ambition you need. But somehow provide the tools that countries need. And I think the question then is, you know, I understand the principle of not, you know, not wanting to undermine trade, but, you know, is it the role of trade law to prescribe what makes good policy, what makes good economic policy? Because ultimately, you can't disentangle, I don't think, climate policy and broader economic policy. They're too linked. So somehow, I think the whole architecture needs to sort of be thought through in a supportive kind of way. And thank you very much for listening to me, and it's been a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, William. It's been great having you here, and safe travels. Okay, for those of us remaining, I'll let our panelists answer the question we just received. I'll then do one last go around, see if anyone has any final questions before we move to concluding remarks. So Jan, Freya, Aaron, whoever would like to provide their insights to that question, please go ahead.
That question?
Yes.
That was more common.
It's a comment, yeah. Yeah, or if you have any responses to the comments as well. I know some of the comments were relative to Aaron's presentation. So Aaron, if you also have any feedback on that.
Sorry, so should I go or is John going to go?
Yes, if you have any responses to the comment we just received.
Sure, yes. I should make clear that I'm not here to defend domestic content requirements as a policy option. Appropriately, I think, finished my presentation by asking the questions, are they appropriate, do we need to make space for them? I don't think, at least in my mind, we have answered those questions. The problem is that in trade policy conversation, I'm usually the only one that's even considering that they might be useful, so I end up sounding like I'm defending them. But and I'll continue to do that, I guess. Why do I think they are such an important tool? Let's take a hypothetical. Let's say that China in the year 2000 had the same ambitions that it has now in terms of rollout of solar and wind power throughout China. And for environment, domestic environmental reasons and also for domestic economic reasons, wants to get away from polluting sources of energy. We've seen the figures about the shaving off of GDP from pollution in China. So there are good reasons for China to want to do this. Let's further suppose that China shuns the use of local content requirements and other industrial policy tools and says we should import these things from other countries that are producing them more cheaply than we could currently produce them. At that time, Germany was the primary producer, as was the United States. Had China done that, today, I would argue that the prices of solar, the levelized cost of installation of solar PV would probably be at least twice what it is now. That is not an economic proposition, that's an environmental problem for the world. So it is possible to do domestic content requirements in such a way that it has a beneficial environmental impact in the long run. Of course, in the short run, if you force a more expensive technology on your developers, it's going to increase the cost of installation of installed power. That's by definition, that's in the nature of domestic content requirements. You increase costs in the short run. By definition, your actual objective is that in the long run, the benefits from that policy actually outweigh the increased costs. So the question is, do those policies work? And I come back to that question. I don't think we've answered it. But it is not self-evident that they do not work just because the short run produces costs. The nature of those policies is to look at long-run effects and to hope that they balance out the short-run costs.
Great. Thank you so much, Aaron. So I'll do one last call for questions before we move to concluding remarks. I know we're running slightly over time, but if anyone has any last questions or comments they'd like to share. Okay, so we will move to our speakers for one last round where you can give a few minutes each just to conclude. And Jan, we'll once again start with you. Thank you.
I don't want to stand between anybody and the drink, so I will just say thank you. It's been a great pleasure to be on this panel. It's been a really interesting and stimulating discussion. And thanks for all the great questions and for the interesting remarks of my co-panelists.
Great. Thanks, Jan. Freya, please go ahead.
I think I fully concur with that, and I will add no further last words.
Okay, well, I don't get to go to drinks myself, so I'm going to talk for at least 15 more minutes. I'll concur. I think I've already talked enough. It's been a very interesting panel, and I thank you all, and I thank ICTSD for allowing me to come at a very low carbon footprint to participate in the panel. And WTI advisors.
We'll toast to you.
Okay, everybody. Well, this concludes our event. On behalf of our co-organizer, WTI Advisors, we at ICTSD would like to thank you all for joining us this evening. We'd like to give a very big thank you to our wonderful speakers, as well as to the Permanent Mission of Finland, the WTO Conference Service, the ICTSD support team, and everyone who's assisted us in organizing this event. We'd also like to kindly remind you about the feedback forms. Just take a couple minutes to give any thoughts, suggestions, feedback you have. That'd be great. And for those of you who are joining us for the reception, that will be upstairs in the atrium, so we'd invite you to head on up there. So thank you again, and we look forward to seeing you next time. Have a good night.